Welcome back to Nostalgic Xer, and today we've got five car companies we want back. This is Xomotive. Let's go! Number 5. Oldsmobile. The Oldsmobile brand sat right in the middle of the traditional GM brand lineup. The order from least expensive to most expensive went Chevrolet, Pontiac, Oldsmobile, Buick, and Cadillac. While not primarily known for performance, the Rocket V8 engines of Oldsmobile became their hallmark and their biggest selling point.
A 280 horsepower Rocket V8.
In the mid to late 1960s, with the muscle car era upon them, Oldsmobile exploited their performance prowess, even forming a partnership with Hurst, a well-known name in performance enhancement.
I'd like to be in on the creation of something new, Jack, and it's nice to have you.
Well, Bud, it's nice to be here, and we're nice to have you in on it. We've had a pretty successful day. We've been out here wringing out suspension and drivetrain components.
With Hurst's help on Hurst Olds and, of course, the Oldsmobile 442, Oldsmobile quickly secured a worthy spot alongside other muscle cars of the time. It was also a time for Oldsmobile to take advantage of the personal luxury coupe market, started by the Ford Thunderbird and then heightened by the Buick Riviera. The Toronado, arguably one of the best-looking cars any GM division ever designed, was born.
Racier than anything on four wheels.
Check out the spinning drum speedometer. Then, a magical thing happened. The affordable, personal luxury car boom. Enter the Oldsmobile Cutlass Supreme. By the time the mid-1970s rolled around, the Cutlass Supreme was America's best-selling car, as well as Oldsmobile sales leader. Some of Oldsmobile's best designs could be seen in the 1960s, but it was in the 1970s that they took luxury to a whole new level. The floating cushion design associated with much higher priced luxury cars of the time became their interior of choice for the top of the line 98 Regency. If there wasn't an Oldsmobile badge on the dash, you could be forgiven if you thought that you were sitting in a Cadillac. Such luxury touches of the 1970s then trickled down to other cars in the Olds lineup as well, making them a more viable player in the mid-priced field. In the 1980s, with a continued focus primarily on luxury, Oldsmobile didn't offer much beyond what other GM divisions were doing, and though it wasn't obvious at first, they began to lose their way. They rode on the success of the Cutlass Supreme name and tried to replicate the Cutlass success by putting the Cutlass moniker on multiple cars. Aside from the Sierra, the strategy didn't work. While Oldsmobile would continue to offer the 442 on a number of different models from the 1970s to the 1990s, it was little more than an appearance package and a slightly better suspension. Little was done to improve the performance of the car, except for maybe the 1991 Quad 4 442 that had a little bit more potency. The 90s brought their intelligent engineering focus, but no one was interested. By the mid-90s, it was time for a brand new direction, and they definitely took it, with the Aurora. It wasn't that Aurora was a bad car, it was just such a departure from everything that we had come to know about Oldsmobile up until this point. It was too different, and even a mid-cycle refresh did nothing to entice buyers into the showroom. The midsize offering the Intrigue sold a little bit better, but it just looked like a Delta 88 with an Aurora front end and rear end. The Alero also gained some of the Aurora styling cues, but it also gained a reputation for having really poor components. The sales numbers for the entire division continued to nosedive, and the writing was on the wall. Oldsmobile would be discontinued as a brand. In 2004, GM did just that, closing the book on Oldsmobile forever. Number 4. Plymouth. With roots in the lower end of the Dodge division combined on occasion with the luxury features of a Chrysler, Plymouth was the ultimate every person's car. There really was something for everyone, whether you were sports-oriented and loved the Barracuda, Roadrunner and Superbird, or you preferred the luxury and comfort of the Fury or the family sensibilities of the Satellite or Duster. It was this middle-of-the-road mentality that fueled some of Plymouth's best-kept secrets. The sleeper cars. Not only could their more performance-oriented cars get a big boost, but even the ones that just basically started of humble beginnings, like the Satellites and Dusters, could easily become drag strip champions with the well-known support system of Mopar Performance Parts and a few turns of the wrench.
They're laying it on you. Are you hip? And that's your Scat Pack and all its goodies they're eyeballing.
Plymouth had one of the most solid reputations of being a formidable opponent on the drag strip, racking up win after win for professional drivers and weekend mechanics as well. And then the disaster of the gas shortage and oil crisis forced automakers to do things differently. Plymouth introduced the Velari, and it turned out to be one of the worst decisions they ever could have made. It was the most recalled car of its time. The Plymouth Velari debacle ended up costing the Chrysler Corporation a bundle. In the early 1980s, the Reliant and other K-car variants, such as the Caravelle, sold well for Plymouth, but they wanted more. They wanted to return to somewhat of a performance-oriented image. And to do so, they introduced the Horizon-based TC3, which would later become the Turismo, and then the revived Duster. They didn't have blistering performance, but it seemed like a start in the right direction. The hope was short-lived, however. By the late 1980s, Plymouth was basically just selling rebadged Dodges, becoming a shadow of their former selves. And speaking of shadows, here's a pop quiz for you.
Pop quiz, hotshot.
Which one of these two pictures is the picture of the Sundance interior? The left or the right? If you said the one on the right, you're our winner of the day. You didn't win anything, but you're still the winner. Congratulations! As the 90s rolled around and all of the other Chrysler divisions received LH platform cab forward design cars, for whatever reason, Plymouth never got one.
You get nothing!
Instead, having to make do with the mid-sized Breeze and the compact Neon, which was the exact same Neon that was available at Dodge dealerships. In 2001, Chrysler shut the doors on Plymouth forever. Number 3. AMC. The merger of Rambler and Nash of the 1960s led to the American Motors Corporation that Gen Xers became familiar with. AMC produced cars that strayed from the expectations of the Big Three automakers. While the Big Three were busy safely designing cars that would hopefully appeal to the largest number of buyers, American Motors proudly created cars that would immediately raise eyebrows for being boldly different. In fact, AMC even proclaimed this mentality in their ads.
If you had to compete with the three biggest car companies in America, what would you do?
From the powerful Javelin to the quirky Gremlin, the head-turning Pacer to the groundbreaking Eagle SX4, AMC, good or bad, like them or not, was always the answer to the humdrum. In a time of muscle car skyrocketing insurance rates that forced automakers to tone down their racy looks, AMC defied the industry and kept on going with their strong, muscular looks on the Javelin. At a time when muscle cars were getting bigger with each new iteration, AMC said, hold on, wait a minute, what if we made a smaller two-seat muscle car? And the AMX was born. The AMX production car comes from an even more radically styled concept car. The concept car also featured two-seat styling, but it differed in that it had a hidden rumble seat that was tucked into the trunk. The concept car also featured no A-pillars. They're not hidden, they're just not there. And what muscle car fan hasn't wondered what could have been if they were able to produce this incredible AMX concept car as the next step in the evolutionary process? The Gremlin looked like a car that had its trunk cut off, and that's essentially what it was. Also, at a time when luxury car manufacturers were teaming up with different luxury designers to create designer editions of their cars, AMC took a different approach with the Gremlin. They teamed with Levi's for a Levi's edition of the car. And before the X package came out on the Gremlin in 1976, AMC was already considering a GT model of the car. AMC was notoriously unapologetic for its forays into the bizarre and weird when it came to car designs, and no car quite epitomized that quite as much as the Pacer, a car with many unique ideas for the time that actually have become ubiquitous in modern cars. AMC's bread and butter platform had already given birth to many other cars throughout the years since its introduction, and in the 1980s, it gave birth to the ultimate one in the AMC Eagle. The Eagle was a go-anywhere wagon and a go-anywhere sedan at a time when that just wasn't heard of in a regular car. It was the world's first crossover, long before crossovers were even thought of as a possibility. In the late 1980s, Chrysler would acquire AMC and turn it into Eagle, a new brand for them filled with rebadged Renaults and Mitsubishis for their lineup. But these were truly the last days for AMC, and Eagles would disappear from the market not long after they were introduced. The quirky and interesting AMC was no more. Number 2. DeLorean. The DeLorean DMC-12 was a car that took aspirations to a whole new level. In the mid-1960s, John DeLorean was riding high on his successes at Pontiac, but he had even bigger aspirations for the brand. He wanted them to have the ultimate sports car. His pet project was initially called XB833, but then became known as the Banshee. The Banshee drew comparisons immediately to the Chevrolet Corvette, and executives at GM were having none of that. The Corvette was their baby, their all-American sports car. They wouldn't allow any other division to have any competition directly with the Corvette. So, John was awarded the Camaro clone project instead, which resulted in the Firebird for Pontiac. John DeLorean, however, had never really put to rest the idea of a strong competitor to the Chevrolet Corvette as the ultimate expression of the American sports car. When John DeLorean left GM in 1973, he went to work on a car that he would introduce as an independent car from his own company. Initially, he wanted to take a page out of the Brooklyn playbook and call his vehicle the DeLorean Safety Vehicle, or DSV for short. While the name didn't stick, the idea of the going doors certainly did. Armed with early ideas in mind, John DeLorean employed the help of Giorgetto Giugiaro, designer of exotic cars like the Fiat 850 Spider, the Ferrari 250 GT Concept, and the Lotus Esprit. John was already enamored with concepts like the Porsche Tupiro and the Hyundai Pony, but he was convinced they could be more than concepts. He tasked Giugiaro with the ultimate challenge of creating the ultimate concept car to be sold to the masses. What resulted was a car that seemed to epitomize the perfection of design, compromising nothing. With gullwing doors and a stainless steel outer body panel construction, the DeLorean was a uniquely gorgeous car to view with little in the way of performance that the car's appearance demanded. Customers didn't really care about the lack of power, however, and they were all too happy to plunk down their deposits for a piece of this DeLorean action, even if said action was just based on looks. A 130 horsepower Peugeot engine didn't really matter when it looked like you just drove a show car right off of its platform at the car show.
The DeLorean. Gullwing doors rise effortlessly, beckoning you inside. The sleek, stainless steel DeLorean.
Commercials and print ads of the time called out for customers to come and live the dream along with DeLorean, and that's exactly what they did.
They tell me that you're the best salesman in the world. If I came to you, how would you sell me one of your cars?
Well, I think, number one, the allegation that I'm a great salesman is a gross exaggeration. Essentially, I'm an engineer, and I like a product, I like technical things. Very proud of our car, which essentially I think is a major engineering contribution to the state of the art of automobiles. I think if I were trying to sell it to you, I'd sell it to you on the basis that it's a very comfortable, outstanding performance, outstanding handling, a car that has, because of its stainless steel skin and the fact that we use all non-corrosive materials in the chassis, a car that will last for many, many years. And as a result, we'll preserve your investment so that in the end, we hope that your cost of owning this car for a long time will be very, very small.
As John DeLorean was getting ready for the release of the DMC-12, he was already working on a second car for the lineup, a four-door family car. As you can see, the design of this car would have been very advanced, especially for its time. This is beyond anything that any other automakers were doing. In 1982, John was caught selling an exorbitant amount of drugs. It turns out, though, that it was far, far more involved than what was originally portrayed in the video of the sting operation.
Because of what happened in the trial, it was unnecessary for me to present a defense because the government essentially proved I was innocent all by themselves, of course, with the help of my attorney, who I think is the brilliant cross-examiner maybe since Clarence Darrow.
Yeah, he really is,
because he caught all these lies and these terrible mistakes and the horrible things they did. Mm-hmm. Well, then we decided not to present our defense and spent another 3 months in court because the jurors were all convinced that, you know, I was absolutely innocent anyhow.
The damage had already been done, however, and John DeLorean's reputation never did recover. He never did make another car again. New life and interest was breathed into the car by way of the Back to the Future movies, where Doc Brown uses it as a time machine.
Are you telling me that you built a time machine out of a DeLorean?
The way I see it, if you're gonna build a time machine into a car, why not do it with some style?
To this day, DeLorean enthusiasts lament the outcome of the company, and no other car stirs up quite as many what-if questions than what a modern DeLorean car would look or perform like today. Number 1. Pontiac. In the 1960s, John DeLorean made a huge difference in the way that Pontiac was marketed. In the late 1950s, the brand was struggling to find an identity that would guarantee repeat buyers. John and his team went to work on creating a new image for Pontiac, and it started with a brand new design language. The new design was crisp and clean, low and sleek, and it had a new twin port grille, a design element that Pontiac would continue to employ for decades to come. With humdrum entry-level styling a thing of the past, now Pontiac could focus on the task at hand and really inject some more fun into their brand with more performance. Pontiacs really were about the performance in this period of time, but sometimes the suspensions were not quite as sport-tuned as you would expect. Sometimes you would get that in an Oldsmobile, for example. But there was no mistaking Pontiac performance, and there was no substitute for it. It was truly awesome. Take it from me. I own a 1978 Trans Am just like the one you see here, and I can tell you that that shaker hood with that 6.6 liter underneath it, pulling you with all that power, pinning you against your seat, was truly an amazing experience. The mid-1970s cafe fuel economy standards were choking the performance of all cars as automakers scrambled to meet the strict government requirements. Pontiac, unlike other automakers, however, never really completely shook off their high-performance image. They bucked the trend, and they were still producing some of the best horsepower and torque ratings in the industry compared to other brands. For example, the Trans Am never really completely gave in to the lower performance numbers that its platform mate, the Camaro, did. Or at least not until 1980, when they introduced the Turbo Trans Am. The 1980s arrived, and Pontiac was working with lighter designs and higher performance as a result, and lots of body cladding. Truth be told, however, that body cladding really did look good on those Pontiacs during those years, and it further distinguished and distanced Pontiac from its stablemates in GM, which was good. As the 1980s flowed into the 1990s, Pontiac continued with their excitement mission, injecting more and more horsepower into all their cars, including Bonneville.
Over 200 horses, powerful, almost angry.
By the time the 2000s rolled around, however, it was a different story. The bold, exciting designs were gone, and they were replaced with more bland styling that you could basically put on any other GM car. An ugly vehicle with the cheapest GM plastics ever put into a vehicle interior that actually had no place in the Pontiac stable like the Aztec didn't help matters either. To put into perspective just how bad the Aztec was for Pontiac and the impact that it had, the Pontiac Solstice Roadster wasn't even enough to save the company. That's how ruined Pontiac's reputation had become. Even after its discontinuation, the specter of the Aztec loomed heavily over Pontiac during its final years, becoming the unwanted symbol of the GM division's failure to live up to its past glory days. GM may have shut down Pontiac forever in 2010, but Gen X muscle car and performance car fans will always hold John DeLorean's Pontiac successes high. Alright everybody, thanks for watching. That's it for this video, and I will see you again soon with the next one. Please remember to hit the subscribe and the bell icon so that you'll be notified when new videos hit. And once again, thanks a whole bunch for watching. Bye for now.